Hello, welcome. I'm Jenna Burrell. I'm an associate professor at the School of Information. And I'm, you know, the reason we're all gathered here today to talk about refusal. So over the summer, travel was canceled. There was a pause between semesters. We had a moment to sort of reflect. Meanwhile, there was quite a lot of chaos going on in the world. And it seemed to me that a conference, even a virtual conference, was called for on this topic. And so I gathered the AFOG team and we started planning this event. And we're really excited today to get to bring together all of these really interesting voices to talk about the concept of tech refusal. I'm gonna get started with a little bit of history and background, and I'm gonna turn over the comments to Deirdre after I say just a few things. Deirdre is the co-director of the Algorithmic Fairness and Opacity Group along with me. So I think for social scientists and historians who study technology, there are a few things that have become common knowledge. One is that artifacts have politics. That something as innocuous as an expressway overpass can be leveraged as a tool of racial and class-based exclusion. We also know that the bicycle was very controversial when it was first invented, contrary to what you may have heard from a recent Netflix documentary. And thirdly, we know that the popular retrospective understanding of the Luddites really misremembers their motives and misstates their objectives. So the Luddites came to attention almost 200 years ago in the early 1800s. They were a group of British skilled machine operators working in the textile industry, and they were riotous in all senses of the word. They were literal machine breakers. They took sledgehammers, they called by the humorous name Great Enoch, and used them to break machines to register their outrage. And the term came from, the term Luddite came from a widely circulating but seemingly apocryphal origin story about a young machine operator named Ned Ludlam, who for some reason that's now unknown, took a hammer to his weaving machine. The Luddites signed their communication in the name of Captain Ludd, who we understand now is an imaginary leader. In fact, the Luddites were a leaderless, decentralized, and collective group. They were working in a time where labor unions were banned. So to make their voices heard, they had to engage in collective action by riot. Their grievances, however, centered not on the fact of these machines they were so bent on breaking, but how those machines were used by some factory owners as an excuse to cut wages and to dominate workers. The Luddites wanted to preserve the skill that went into their work and the quality of their product. And the machines were just visible targets. Their outrage was really not about or against particular machines. This message of the Luddites was later distorted by a particular Western tech ideology that equates tech with progress. Luddite came to mean something really different. It's now a word we hear often to represent the idea of irrational tech resistors, a person who's unwilling to change with the times, who, because they reject, resist, or avoid tech, is against progress itself. I'm gonna fast forward us to 1964, when the UC Berkeley campus where I work was in an upheaval in the midst of the civil rights movement. Political activism on campus had been restricted by the administration. And a student protester, Mario Savio, made a very famous speech. I'm going to quote from the speech right now. "There's a time when the operation of the machine becomes so odious, makes you so sick at heart that you can't take part. You can't even passively take part. You've got to put your bodies upon the gears and upon the wheels, upon the levers, upon all the apparatus, and you've got to make it stop. You've got to indicate to the people who run it, to the people who own it, that unless you're free, the machine will be prevented from working at all." So the machine here was the university itself, with the students as raw material. This is a use of metaphor, and I think it's best understood within its particular technological era. This was with the rise of the Cold War and the not at all distant memory of the technologies of World War II, of optimized inhumanity. Savio's speech came at the dawn of a particular era, one in which tools and technologies wielded by the powerful began to be challenged more directly. There's a great recent book from 2019 by Matt Tierney titled Dismantlings, where he writes about this time period from 1965 to 1980 as the long 70s. And he talks about how that era gave rise to a new form of tech resistance and tech's reinvention. So metaphorical acts of machine breaking, I think Mario Savio's speech is a sort of metaphorical act of machine breaking, that renewed ideas about technology away from the weapons of war of World War II and the Cold War to ideas around communitarianism and cyberculture. In Tierney's book, he reclaims Luddism as a part of, as a kind of counter lexicon, and that there's a lesson in machine breaking, whether we're talking about material or metaphorical machines, that by breaking apart certain machines, he says, we can learn to use them better or never use them again. By dissecting certain technocentric cultural logics, we can likewise challenge or reject them. So both machines and logics that they that underlie those machines. So last year's abundance of examples of refusal inspired this conference, in particular, the refusal of facial recognition technologies. And that happened through municipal legislation that prohibited its use by city agencies such as the police. My home, Oakland, passed some legislation like this. So did San Francisco, Portland, Boston. And along with this came several decisions by high-tech firms that struck me as unusual. I mean, perhaps in ensuing discussions, we'll hear about other precedents, but this seemed unusual to me. And these were decisions to pause development, circumscribe use, and sometimes abandon altogether the development of facial recognition products by major firms like IBM, Microsoft, Amazon, and Google. And not only were they pressing pause, they were doing so very publicly. Along with this were calls, there were calls by scientists and by, in particular, the major professional organization of computer scientists, the Association of Computing Machinery, to halt the development and use of facial recognition technologies. So what brought about this shift at this moment in time? Were calls by the public or particular efforts by social movements heard, acknowledged, and heeded? And to what extent did the internal pressure in organizations or the efforts of employees affect these outcomes? We have some of the people involved in some of these decisions present at the conference to shed some light on this. And I'm going to turn it over to Deirdre now.
There we go. I couldn't unmute myself. Damn, I'm being controlled. All right. So lawyers engaged in social justice work and those who seek to invoke the powers of legal institutions are very familiar with refusal, right? It's a key part of practice. Part of the reason when I was starting my career, I chose to work at the Privacy and Technology Project of the ACLU as opposed to some of the other pieces of it, was that I actually thought it might be, I might be able to couple refusal with construction. And because so much of a lawyer's life is about saying no. A common goal in social justice litigation is to stop an objectionable behavior. Injunctive relief is authorized and often the key remedy sought by social justice lawyers in federal courts. While injunctions can require a defendant to undertake a particular activity, more often they are used to prohibit particular acts. Injunctions have been used as a technology, as a tool for refusing technologies. They've been used to limit private companies' design and use of technology in particular ways. For example, challenging the design and use of Facebook's ad platform that allowed and encouraged employers, employment agencies, and those placing housing advertisements to exclude individuals from receiving advertisements based on race, gender, age, disability, and other protected classes, because such targeting violates civil rights laws that prohibit discrimination in employment and housing. While an injunction didn't issue in that case, the settlement that resolved them made significant changes to Facebook's advertising tools. It prescribed the ways in which they behave. Similarly, we see injunctions used to constrain the conditions under which governments can use certain technologies. So for example, litigation in several states has established that law enforcement must obtain a warrant based on probable cause prior to using stingrays, also known as cell site simulators or IMC catchers. These invasive cell phone surveillance devices that mimic cell phone towers and send out signals to trick our phones into providing location and identifying information. The logic supporting these refusals, commitments to non-discrimination, and constraints on overreaching government surveillance are probably very familiar to and comfortable bases for many of us in the room. When we turn to the legislative arena, which is where I spent my early career, we see a much broader range of logics for refusing technology. Reflecting on some of my early experience as an activist and lawyer, refusing a whole range of technologies broadly construed through different means, I was reminded of just how wide the logics were, both those that brought me to the table, but even more importantly, the ones that brought other participants into various coalitions of refusal. So from autonomy, justice, and beneficence, right, the key tenets of research ethics in a kind of Western frame, which form the bases for teach-ins and sit-ins and shout-ins and sign-ins and chain-ins that I organized as a young person in response to AIDS clinical trials, right? The first one in particular in which women could participate, that treated them as objects, as a vector for administering drugs to the children in their womb rather than treating them as subjects of medical care. And care generally. To some of my first work at the ACLU and the Center for Democracy and Technology, opposing the creation of a national computerized registration system for all American workers, which was criticized as a crucial first step toward the implementation of a national identification card system for all American workers, which brought together a very broad coalition. It included religious groups opposed to national identification numbers because of the biblical prophecy about the mark of the beast. It included companies concerned about the added complexity and time an error-prone, unreliable, nationally networked system would introduce into hiring. It brought together organizations representing immigrants and other historically marginalized individuals who were likely to suffer the consequences of shoddy data, of downtimes and unresponsive appeals processes, and civil liberties and civil rights groups concerned about privacy, freedom of association, and discrimination more broadly. Whether you opposed a national ID card because it might wrongly deny you a job, was the mark of the beast, the long shadow of Big Brother, a further way to marginalize oppressed groups in society, or an administrative headache, I didn't care. The policy process makes really strange bedfellows, but coalitions are often essential to social movements. Sometimes advocates seek to materialize a marketplace refusal, right? Pressures from business partners, investors, and customers can lead companies to rethink the technologies they unleash on the marketplace. For example, many years ago when Intel announced the Pentium serial number, some of you might remember, but most of you are probably too young, which would have operated like a license plate attached to the computers that had Intel inside. I reached out to all the OEM customers asking them how they plan to implement the new feature. And I promised to publish all the results. And against the news stories worried about the privacy apocalypse and a Federal Trade Commission complaint and a very headline catching but hard to realize idea of a consumer boycott, all the OEMs said they would turn it off in the BIOS, basically neutering the tracking risk posed by the technology and its tracks. Sometimes refusal is a result of spontaneous, sometimes playful, uncoordinated grassroots activity rather than a highly coordinated strategy. The netting and shooting of drones from the sky, the banning of Google glasses from bars and health clubs, and reasserting social norms by coining new words such as Google glasshole. These are all refusals. And while they're important in their own way, Jenna and I really want to focus us on political movements for refusal. For as Ruha Benjamin reminds us, the notion of a personal right to refuse privately is not a tenable solution for many, if not most. For such private refusals depend upon technical knowledge, power, deep pockets, or all three, making reliance on it a sure way to further entrench the inequities in society. Finally, circling back to Jenna's opening comment, like historians and social scientists, lawyers, at least some of them, know that artifacts have politics, and those distinct politics have served as a basis for refusal. from key escrow architectures to digital rights management technologies to crypto backdoors to internet voting proposals, lawyers aided by the research and voices of computer scientists, and at times in partnership with them, have used the distinct limitations of a specific technology. Its brittleness, its lack of nuance, its inability to handle exceptions, its inability to dynamically and fluidly respond to shifts in cultural norms as a basis for refusal. Technical constraints could not be simply swapped in for legal ones without damaging the meaning and purpose of law and governance. So this brings us to meeting the moment. It is this particular moment of protest around facial recognition that brought Jenna and I to bring you together. There's a long history of refusing biometric technologies, but this moment is different and it feels different. The rise of the Black Lives Matter movement has starkly documented the lived experiences of Black citizens aided in part by technology as smartphones and police-worn body cameras, right, making over-policing and police violence vividly and viscerally apparent to the country broadly, not just to Black people. And the BLM movement and the awareness it's fueled is raising the political power of campaigns against surveillance based in racial injustice. So we see the technocratic arguments about biased performance that once dominated some of the discussion about facial recognition and identification systems more broadly have been replaced by arguments about power and politics, about the connection between facial recognition and what Simone Brown terms digital epidemiolization. Boy, I shouldn't try to say that word. The imposition of race on the body through the classification and schematization of human features, the harms to marginalized populations that flow from such digital epidemiolization, and the distinctions between policing and protecting, epitomized by the disembodied electronic eyes of video surveillance networks littered across our cities and the wholesale reworking of social conventions in many countries and cultures that would be required to resist their gaze. So the logics of freedom of expression and association, arguing that facial recognition chills First Amendment rights by exposing protesters to persistent surveillance and identification, the logics of privacy that we need to limit government overreaching and protect private lives from scrutiny, even in public places, are now, I suggest, subsumed in logics about the insidious racism of using algorithms driven by statistical methods to arbitrarily divide human populations. That brings us to today and tomorrow and Friday. So over the course of the next few days, we will explore refusal as a way to break free from the simple assumption of tech as a relentless march of progress, to take a pause, to resist doubling down, to resist the proposal that tech problems require tech fixes. We will consider the logic supporting refusals, what frameworks, values, modes of argument were useful, the evidence that was available or necessary to influence key stakeholders, the strategies and tactics that propelled successful refusals, the coalitions and partners necessary to advance them, the structures within firms that might shape internal pathways and in turn the possibilities for different kinds of refusing, and how company business models or sectors of the economy or consumer or business relationships might shape further the spaces in which we can refuse. And finally, the consequences and lasting impacts of refusals, be it the rejection of a specific technology or application of market, the emergence of new policies or contract language or prohibitions, individuals or groups gaining power and visibility in their struggles, stronger coalitions, re-understandings of what technologies mean, not just in theory, but in practice. And with that, I'm going to hand it back over to Jenna.
There we go. So this work on refusal is really situated in the broader interest of our group, AFOG, with thinking as broadly as possible about the solution space for tech problems and possibilities. Our focus has been in the group over the last 3 years on the widening application of machine learning and AI technologies. And I think we agree that critique can be powerful. Refusal is critique, but it's also critique wedded to action. tech, like all other material forms, can be powerfully aligned to human interests and values. Digital technologies can be liberatory. And to stop certain tech trajectories is to open up space for new tech possibilities. Before we jump headlong into this idea that tech is both problem and solution, just a quick reminder that solutions can take many, many forms. We might look to discursive solutions, sort of changing the language and framing to make things that were once invisible now visible. We might look to organizational solutions. So that could include processes of review within corporations or other institutional bodies. It could include things like reporting structures. We might ask questions about corporate leadership. It could include legislative and policy solutions, as Deirdre has talked about just prior to my comments. Structures of rulemaking and practice, redistributing control between private and the public sector. It could include grassroots solutions, forms of do-it-yourself, direct action, collectives, mutual aid groups that redistribute control into the hands of those who are impacted by these systems, the stakeholders or users. So by starting with clarity about what not, maybe we can make room for what instead. Another quote from Ruha Benjamin, very important person to be reading as we think about refusal. She says that we should remember to imagine and craft the worlds you cannot live without, just as you dismantle the ones you cannot live within. So during this pause in business as usual, we have an opportunity to take stock and to ensure we don't reopen the world as it was, but reopen the world as we wish it to be. We have the opportunity to refuse technologies and other systems that are at odds with justice. We've brought together speakers from across many types of organizations that might be interested in refusal: academia and industry, nonprofits, government agencies, advocacy and activist groups. And we hope through our conversations to work between the many ways of acting in the world, affecting change on, over, or through tech. And that I think that's good for our opening comments. I wanted to just do a little bit of administrative stuff first. So we have two panels in the next 2 hours, and you are able to ask questions. We encourage you to ask questions of the speakers. There's a Q&A button that you can use to pose questions. I think that's everything for administrative stuff. We'll take a few moments and get situated with the next session, which is the authors of the Feminist Data Manifesto, most of whom are already here in the webinar, and we'll do a little bit of reorganizing to get them on screen for you. Any other comments, Deirdre?
I can't unmute myself. Only to say thank you to Daniel Griffin and Zoe Kahn, who have worked tirelessly to help us put this program together and to put together the goodie bags that at least some of you probably received, and have been not just kind of implementing, but really essential to helping us envision this work in the way that all really terrific PhD students do.
All right, I think we'll put up our pause slide and get reorganized for the next session.
All right, should we get started? Okay. No. No is short word, a snap perhaps. No is negative speech, a complaint. No is what you say when you do not want to proceed, when you do not agree to something. No is an address delivered to a person or made against a system or given in a situation. No what you announce by what you do or do not do with your body, as gesture, as withdrawal. No as a story of how someone comes to refuse what had previously been endured. No as political action, how a collective is formed by saying enough is too much. No as costly, when you're willing to say or do despite the consequences, whatever the consequences. Noah's achievement, what we say for each other, what we pick up from each other. Know as what is behind you when you start over, when you try something out, when you go another way. This is a poem by Sar Ahmed from June 2017. And I wanted to start off with it because Sara's work has been so influential in our own work. I'm really excited to introduce the authors of the Feminist Data Manifest Know. We're gonna have a really interesting conversation about how the Manifest Know came together and what the group thinks about refusal and its place. So first I'm gonna introduce everyone and then we'll get into the questions. And I encourage everyone who's listening to also add questions to the Q&A and I will ask them. So we're joined today by Anita Chen, who will be joining us a little bit later. She's an associate professor at the School of Information at the University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign. Her research and teaching interests include globalization and digital cultures, innovation networks, and the periphery, science and technology studies in Latin America, and hybrid pedagogies in building digital literacies. Anna Lauren Hoffman is an assistant professor at the School of Information at the University of Washington. Her work centers on issues in information, data, and ethics, paying particular attention to how discourses surrounding data science and technology, especially around terms like fairness or inclusion, can work to promote or undermine the pursuit of social justice. Jasmine Ralt is an assistant professor of media studies in the Department of Arts, Culture, and Media and the Faculty of Information at the University of Toronto. Ralt's research focuses on mediations of gender, race, and sexuality in architecture and design, digital cultures, and economies, arts, and social movements. Marika Sifor is an assistant professor in the School of Information at the University of Washington. She's a feminist scholar working at the intersections of archival studies and digital studies. Her research investigates how through archives, records, and data produced within digital cultures, individuals and communities marginalized by sexuality, race, class, gender, and HIV status enact and give substance to their identities, collective memories, and social movements. Patricia Garcia is an assistant professor in the School of Information at the University of Michigan. She conducts interdisciplinary action research that studies how girls' intersectional experiences impact their persistence and achievement in computing. Her work challenges stereotypes of girls of color as passive victims of technology and provides a counter narrative that highlights girls' generative and agentic relationships with technology. T.L. Cohen is an assistant professor of media studies in the Department of Arts, Culture, and Media and the Faculty of Information at the University of Toronto. T.L.'s research creation focuses on theories of reception, cultural and intellectual economies, networks and methods of transfeminist and queer digital media and performance practices. Tanya Sutherland is an assistant professor in the Department of Information and Computer Science at the University of Hawaii at Manoa. Global in scope, her research focuses on entanglements of technology and culture, with particular emphasis on critical and liberatory work within the fields of archival studies, digital studies, and science and technology studies. Her work critically examines the analog histories of modern information and communication technologies and addresses trends of racialized violence in 21st century digital cultures. And finally, I'm Nilfar Salehi. I'm an assistant professor at UC Berkeley's iSchool. My research is in HCI, social computing, collective action. More recently, I've been really interested in online harms, such as harassment, abuse, and thinking about what frameworks of justice, like restorative justice, transformative justice, and distributive justice can teach us about the design of socio-technical systems. I'm really excited to be moderating this panel, and I wanted to start with a very basic question of why refusal? And to invite Patricia to start us with the story of how we got together and how we wrote the Manifest Now.
Thanks for having us and for the introductions. So we didn't actually start, we didn't get together with the purpose of discussing refusal. Marika Sifor and I organized, camp. I don't even know what to call it. I guess it was a workshop. It felt like camp because there was a lot of bonding. At University of Michigan, And really, we started with just a pretty broad question of what a feminist approach to studying data could look like. And as you can tell from the introductions, we invited just a wide range of scholars, but we were particularly interested in scholars from schools of information or iSchools. And so what we did as one of the opening activities is we asked people to bring in a propositional object. And this was supposed to be, you know, object loosely defined that represented in some way a feminist approach to studying data. And Anna, which I don't know if she'll talk about it or share it in the chat, but created, crowdsourced some memes around the word no. And, you know, a meme that would be representative of the word no. And that was her propositional object. And that eventually got us to Ruha's tweet, a tweet that reads, "Note to selves, remember to imagine and craft the worlds you cannot live without, just as you dismantle the ones you cannot live within." And so from this conversation sort of jumped off into Refusal and sort of the intellectual lineage of Refusal. And we talked to, you know, obviously about Benjamin's work, Tuck and Yang, Audra Simpson, Ahmed. And I know TL and Jazz are gonna talk a little bit more about sort of the intellectual lineage that we drew from. But yeah, so we decided that Refusal could be a really generative concept for thinking about a feminist approach to studying. And let me see if there's anything else that I missed. So I think just in terms of, you know, what critical refusal means to us, we sort of articulated it as an informed practice of talking back, borrowing from some of the authors we just spoke about, and really as a way to help us know when to stop our research and practice. So when to stop collecting data that doesn't support the rights of communities, when to stop designing and building systems that introduce disproportionate risk and harm. And through all of this, I think we spent about a day or two brainstorming and then just sat together and collaboratively wrote the manifest no and decided that it was gonna be very important to have a structure that included a refusal and a commitment because we felt that was really what was true to the ethos of the concept of refusal.
And I think just adding on to what Pat said, I want to make sure we thank the Institute for Research on Women and Gender at the University of Michigan, who kindly funded our ability to be in a room together thinking and making for a few days. To just say, right, we began the drafting project of the Manifesto in August together at the workshop. By furiously typing around a table. And I think we all got so excited by the work and thinking we were doing that we ended up spending an extra kind of half day together writing. But it was then and just kind of brain dumping everything we had onto our Google Doc. There's some fun pictures of us all sitting at a long table, just furiously typing. But out of that, right, also, people individually and collectively spent the next kind of few months refining and reorganizing and thinking about those principles that eventually became kind of both the short and long version of the Manifesto, which we can make sure it goes in the chat as well.
Thank you. I wanted to follow up with that question with a very basic question of what do you think is the power and the potential of refusal?
I think I'm supposed to take this. So I already kind of alluded a little bit to it, but we chose refusal because it doesn't just simply imply an act of negation. Refusal is intentionally generative and strategic. It's, you know, for us, it was important for it to be grounded in a justice-oriented framework and not just an ethics framework. And maybe Tanya can jump in at some point, but you know, Tanya really beautifully has been expressing some ideas around, you know, refusal as creating the conditions for possibility for negation and action. I think refusal for us, as mentioned in the opening statement by Deidre and Jenna, was that it's really important for us to be able to pair a refusal with an action. And for us, the refusals were easy. I mean, those were just like flying when we were writing the manifesto and brainstorming together. The refusals were just flying out of our mind and thoughts, and following that up with doing the work of a commitment. And, you know, the commitment doesn't have to be a solution. The commitment is just is an attempt to do something different, to stop, to pause, to take a different avenue. And so I think for us, that was why refusal was so generative, because it forced us to think about alternatives.
Yeah, I'll just add just very briefly onto what Pat said, that, you know, refusal it makes space for alternative narratives. So it's a place, as Pat said, about conditions of possibility, right? So it's not just that you're saying no to something. In that space between the refusal and the commitment is the condition of possibility to form a new narrative, to do a new thing, to move in a new direction, to envision a new world, as Ruha kind of charged us to do, to build the world that you want to live in, and not just speak to the world that you don't want to live in.
And I think just building on what Pat and Tanya have already said, right? I think it's important that we be clear that this work is right in conversation with projects that began before ours and projects that continue on. And I think it's useful. I think part of the challenge too is not just of writing commitments, but of thinking about how we actually, what this work actually looks like in the world. And I hope that kind of during our conversation and Q&A that other, and over the next few days, right, that we can think more about kind of what this actually looks like in the world. All of us in kind of in full and in smaller groups have also been thinking about what, how to actually take some of the kind of concepts from the manifesto and build on them, and to look for how they're already kind of at work and in conversation with other projects. And I just wanted to highlight, since we'll also be fortunate enough to hear from Tawana Petty in a few days, how much particularly our data bodies has been kind of influential to our thinking. And we think represents a really beautiful and powerful example of thinking complexly. In particular, there's kind of one point from the manifesto, 27, if you make it that far, in which we talk about the refusal of appropriation of feminist discourses of safety and languages of consent for the legitimization of surveillance, and call for a rethinking of what safety and solidarity and harm reduction and self-defense and empowerment might look like in these contexts. And there's all sorts of groups of activists and artists and scholars who are really doing this powerful refusal work out in the world. And we hope this work speaks to them, and that we together can advance these work and conversations.
Thank you so much, Marika. And that's a really great segue into my next question. I wanted to hear about what traditions, including academic or otherwise, do you think that refusal, or the way that we think about refusal, build on? And I wanted to invite Jazz and TL to share their thoughts on this.
Hi, I wonder if you can see us. It's such a, oh no.
No.
Now great. You should be able to see us. Oh, yes. What a peculiar experience this has been.
Yay.
Fantastic.
Hi, everybody.
Hi. TL and I normally live in Toronto, a city that has been a kind of thriving cosmopolitan international center of activity for over 15,000 years, right? And we do our best to learn from and honor the relationships forged and ongoing there. So this is traditional territory of many nations, including the Anishinaabe Mississaugas of the Credit, and Ojibwe peoples, the Haudenosaunee Confederacy and Wendat peoples, and continuously home to many First Nation, Inuit, and Métis people. The territory is importantly subject to the Dish with One Spoon Wampum Belt Covenant, And this is an agreement between Anishinaabe and Haudenosaunee people to peaceably share and care for the area around the Great Lakes region, all the way up the St. Lawrence River, like up to Montreal. This agreement was violated through several iterations of the Toronto Purchase, starting in 1787 and then again in 1805, and continuing into the most recent 2010 settlement. And we live with and in this violation. So right now we're calling in from an area a few hours north in Anishinaabe territory, closer to the Shawanaga First Nation. We're guests and uninvited visitors in these lands. And we want to imagine and practice ways of being good guests, of orienting our work and our priorities in the direction of and in support of those who have cared for this area and these lifeways for thousands of years. So for us, refusal is pretty rooted in Indigenous modes of survivance, practiced and elaborated by communities of activists, artists, and academics, and just communities of existence, against the ongoing violences of the settler colonial state, and its extension in extraction economies, tech companies, and academic research. So from scholars like Audra Simpson, Leanne Simpson, Eve Tuck, Kiwen Yang, Glenn Coulthard, just like off the top of my head, we learn that refusal is generative, right? A generative practice, praxis of survivance. And it's an ongoing assertion of an authority beyond settler colonial certainties, politics, scholarship, and solutions. So it's for us very rooted in this idea that refusal is a no to coercive settler colonial logics of recognition, inclusion, and participation, and a yes to truly decolonial resource and information management and anti-colonial research practices, where we might come in the anti-colonial research priorities side. As a form of Indigenous information management, refusal means setting limits around what information can be shared, what's offered to the commons, what needs protecting, and provides really fundamental challenges to liberal, white, settler colonial versions of truth, justice, ideals like the commons. And actually Kim Kristen's work that's coming right after this is just so really valuable and formative in thinking through what it means to challenge the idea that all information wants to be free. I mean, that's a beautiful essay that I teach and teach. When Black and Indigenous people refuse to share access to the resources, knowledges, and information that they have cultivated, cared for, and generated, we really see starkly the extent to which liberalism is designed to protect white settler colonial property, possession, values, and our sense of justice, the settler colonial common sense of goodness. Gita is a nice place to think about practicing these forms of refusal as a international Indigenous data alliance. So the Global Indigenous Data Alliance that brings together a whole bunch of Indigenous data sovereignty movements in different places, including in the US. But, you know, formed in 2019 as a way to sort of centralize information around Indigenous data sovereignty, which really is based in no, right? In a refusal to continuously extract and extract and extract from Indigenous knowledges, lifeways, and forms of passing on information.
Yeah. Information technology
and information technologies. I'm just thinking, I have a few more things to say, but I think you should talk.
Okay. So hi everyone. Oh my God. I woke up this morning. I was like, why aren't we in California? That would be so fun. And then as I was thinking that, and Jazz and I were thinking about what we're going to chat about today, mostly just so excited to see all of you. We're thinking, you know, should we engage with a land acknowledgement, even though we're all in different places? And we were thinking about the ways that doing everything on Zoom reproduces this kind of terra nullius of placelessness, right? That there is nothing there, that there was nothing ever there, that there is nowhere, there is no place, which the more and more we absorb the feeling of placelessness, the more and more the anti-colonial project of you know, the return of lands and Indigenous sovereignty of land, water, air, cultural lifeways is forgotten, or because it makes it much more possible for it to be off the agenda. So we wanted to start with that, just to kind of, you know, really think about this condition of placelessness that we're in now, and how that reproduces more and reproduces the legitimizing ways in which resources are stolen from Indigenous territories all the time. Resources in terms of knowledge, in terms of natural resources, in terms of cultural ways.
In terms of data.
And so our current life condition is making it even more and more difficult to have a land-based, place-based ethics of practice. So I just wanted to add that. And then the thing that I've been thinking about in response to this question, Nilufar, is in addition to the legacies and leadership of Indigenous scholars, I also am like, I read Adrian Rich's Compulsory Heterosexuality and Lesbian Existence as like a women's studies student in the 90s. And at the time I was semi out. I was bisexual. Sorry. I don't know if anyone else finds that a funny joke, but I always do. not supposed to laugh. And so I just became completely convinced by Rich's argument around compulsoriness. And then when Robert McClure built on Rich's analysis and framework and published Compulsory Able-Bodiedness and Queer Disabled Existence, I was just like, and that was in 2006 and Rich's was in 1980. I also began, you know, in earnest to think about compulsoriness and all the ways that it functions. And so that's my approach and my kind of like lineage that I trace my own kind of thinking around critical feminist data studies to. And so Rich says about compulsory heterosexuality, in the absence of choice, women, and you know, Rich is potentially a TERF. She never disowned her TERFness, her trans exclusion feminism. And so I use her kind of in advisedly, but I do think this analysis is good. In the absence of choice, women will remain dependent on the chance or luck of particular relationships and will have no collective power to determine the meaning and place of sexuality in their lives. And so I just wanna like rephrase that. In the absence of choice, women and everyone will remain dependent on the luck or chance of particular relationships and will have no collective power to determine the meaning and place of data in their lives. So I'm thinking about data collecting as this compulsory system in which we really are relying on luck and chance, that the companies that are scraping our data and using the information about our lives will do so in a way that won't do harm. But we know that that is 100% not true. So one of the things that I also think about is when you go on Twitter and you get a sign, a little pop-up that says you're in control, and you can either click, which is a nice bright blue welcoming button, turn on personal ads, or a shitty like little like faded thing that doesn't even look like something you could click that says keep less relevant ads. So either like use my personal data in order to customize my ad experience on Twitter, or keep less relevant ads. Likewise, Project Muse on their database displays a banner at the bottom of the screen that reads, "This website uses cookies to ensure you get the best experience on our website. Without cookies, your experience may not be seamless." And so the argument about your experience being seamless is 100% the argument that buttresses compulsory heterosexuality and compulsory able-bodiedness and compulsory able-mindedness, right? And I wanna just pop over to McClure, who says, "A system of compulsory able-bodiedness repeatedly demands that people with disabilities embody for others an affirmative answer to the unspoken question, yes, but in the end, wouldn't you rather be more like me?" And so I think that our refusal to this compulsoriness is the answer, no, I wouldn't like to be more like you. No, I wouldn't like a more seamless experience. No, I wouldn't like Yes, I would like less relevant ads. Thank you very much. And so basically, the thinking for me around the genealogy of the feminist and critical disability or CRIP scholars thinking about compulsoriness is that these daily practices in which it's an endless repetition of non-choices. And that we are offered these choices, but there is actually no choice at all. It's either you choose to have a non-seamless existence. So you choose to live with homophobia, you choose to live with lesbophobia, you choose to live with ableism, or you acquiesce to the dominant hegemonic data norms, for example, and just fucking suck it up, right? And I think that this is, you know, as a CRIP and as a dyke, I am very invested in the answer no to those things. I'm not gonna just suck it up. And I think that for me, that is the intellectual, political, and affective genealogy for my thinking with all of you in the manifesto.
Thank you so much for that really, really fascinating conversation. Does anyone want to add to that question? I think everyone's just blown away and has a lot to think about. I'm going to move on to the next question. So as we think about refusal, I was wondering what we should keep in mind. And we could use the example of all of the work that we did for putting together the Feminist Data Manifest. What do you think are the things that we should make sure that we keep in the front of our minds when we think about refusal, and especially during the rest of this conference?
Anita or Tanya or anyone want to take that?
Well, one thing is that, I am constantly reminded that refusal is collective action, right? It's not necessarily just something that you do on your own. It's not just a matter of individual choice, but that it really is about pulling people together and saying no as a collective. I've just completely repeated what I originally said much more succinctly.
I'll add to Tanya's comments and also some of the comments that have been already made, and my apologies for having to come in late to everyone, and it's really great to see everyone's faces in the space together. And thanks again to the organizers as well. But a kind of collective move that's not just about a kind of push against a kind of given state, but that's also generously generative and is much about crafting and imagining the worlds we can't live without as much as dismantling the ones that we certainly don't want to live within. And so when we come together and when this group has been coming together, I mean, it strikes me how deeply vitalizing and re-energizing those moments have been and how generous they are. And you know, we come together to get to create these moments, to get to build collectively, but we think about building and the kinds of things that we generate is quite multifaceted and multi-formatted. So sometimes they look like tools or toolkits, but sometimes they're sort of resources that defy kind of standard quantitative formats by all means. They're really meant to be things, I think, more than anything that are a nod to the kinds of diverse and inclusive publics and civics and collectivities that we think of ourselves as part of and as owing back to. So we certainly don't think of ourselves as only speaking back to the academy. And we think about the kinds of resources, it's always struck me that the resources when we think about co-building and co-creating together, it's very much in conversations with pasts, with the kind of long legacy of feminist, anti-colonial, decolonial, anti-racist data thinkers who are not just part of the 21st century, this kind of moment, but who really date back to the 19th century and beyond, Ida B. Wells, W. Du Bois, et cetera, coming together. But again, also much like them, not thinking of our tools as only speaking for or back to the academy, but really being quite distributive and trying to speak for and recognize data justice as a project that's about diverse solidarities across audiences, across different kinds of sectors. So when we, even the manifesto as a kind of format speaks to that in a sense. And when we've thought of that or performed that or lived with that as a kind of living document, it's not just in text and on paper, but as collective readings that we've organized that include activists and artists, people inside the academy, people outside of the academy, people of multi-generations that explicitly draw in voices from tech centers and different tech centers. So, you know, work on the ground in grassroots collectives that are pushing back and for different kinds of data futures. We've organized workshops in different kinds of spaces, whether it's at CSCW or at the Allied Media Conference. And again, really trying to make a nod to and give back to the different kinds of audiences and sectors that have been feeding and generative for us. And really try to embrace formats that intentionally demystify data practice. And so things like a manifesto or a feminist manifesto playlist, shout out to Jazz TL, those kinds of formats really speak to knowledge practices on the ground and from different kinds of centers of knowledge production that again, we want to see ourselves as working in traditions of, maybe as a kind of really one last nod to kind of make a gesture towards, you know, again, and to acknowledge the kinds of things that I've learned collectively through working with this group, and things to maybe underscore for the conference in terms of moving forward is how much the kinds of practices that this group has been working around are ones that are really intentionally and deliberately inclusive, but also the work that it takes to build that in, stretching across different kinds of time zones, working really hard to try and come together across a range of time zones where we know everyone's already working hard to try and find time just to meet for an hour together. So that means that the work can be slow, sometimes slow, feels slow or requires additional patience, but it's as a kind of nod to the notion that we're not trying to reproduce tech times. We're really trying to work intentionally for a kind of version of shared collective time. Again, as a kind of nod to some of the things that scholars like Ruha Benjamin have plotted out as core principles for digital liberation, the notion of valuing things like equity over efficiency, a social good over market imperatives, or what she writes about is working slower as a means to protect people. I think that's something that this group and working with this group has really brought a lot of clarity and somatic clarity over and for. So yeah, that's my sort of bit. And others may want to build on to us since we are such a large collective.
One thing that I've been thinking a lot about is very practically, what are the mechanisms by which we can refuse and when? And some of this goes back to my experiences and trainings as an organizer. One of the things that we would do is think about all of the things that you can do, all of the axes that you can put pressure on, whoever you want to change, all of the levers that you can pull, and just list them and then try to do all of them at the same time. And I've been thinking a lot about what that means in the sense of the kinds of technologies that we're talking about refusing. What are the stages of a technology's development from the points where it's being designed and maybe in a research setting to the point where it's being deployed and to the point where it's an existing technology that's embedded within infrastructures and is sort of really difficult to change at that point because it's embedded within existing practices. And I've been really inspired by the ways that people have been refusing at all of these steps. I was really inspired by a collective letter that academics wrote about a paper that had ethically dubious uses of facial expression analysis that a lot of people signed on to. And I thought that the letter itself was so educational in explaining what's wrong with this. And I think that's just really helpful for people, especially students, to read. To the point of employees walking out, people pushing on, you know, new laws and ways to go through the legal system to stop things from happening. So one of the things that I would really like to forefront for us to think about in the rest of the conference is, what are those different ways? How can they be effective? And how can we, you know, create the energy and the resources to be able to do all of them at the same time?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
So I'm gonna take a second and I think synthesize a lot of what we've heard across these these comments. And I think in order to address make somewhat systematic this this idea of refusal as core in a feminist analytic, or refusal as a kind of analytic itself, and I'll try to pull on these various threads. If we're going to think about refusal as a kind of analytic, and I think that it's something that will be useful both for the conference and then folks sort of going outward and beyond, you know, thinking of refusal as an analytic means, you know, not thinking about it just in terms of bare rejection or worse, like, you know, mere obstinance or something, but as a way of making sense of the world, as a way of making sense of something, whether that's a system, a tool, a way of knowing, a method. And so here we see that we can see one literal definition of refusal as, you know, to literally decline an offer, right? I decline what is being offered to me. And built into that definition is engagement with the world as it is, right? So it's not, you know, just reaction or action, right? It is theory and practice. It is recognizing the terms of what's being offered to us. And in this way, I think it's amenable to what Charles Mills, Elizabeth Anderson, and others have called the sort of non-ideal approach to ethics, which is ethics that sets out from the facts of oppression, dispossession, and violence, as opposed to an ethics that sets out from abstract ideals that are detached from those facts. And as an explicitly feminist analytic, then we might think of refusal as sort of the project of, you know, what bell hooks defined as resistance to sexist, as opposition to sexist oppression. So refusal as a expressly feminist analytic then is going to take us into the necessary project of both understanding and declining the terms set by patriarchy and misogyny and notions of compulsoriness that come along with that, as TL laid out, and as well as its various sort of forms and interdependencies, white supremacy and racial capitalism, cis and heterosexism, ableist norms, and beyond. So that, I think, is kind of, that starts to get us towards like what refusal is doing as a feminist analytic. And I think we could break that down into three sort of concrete sort of prescriptions that we might pull out of that broad idea. And the first, so, is this obvious baseline work of refusal itself, understanding what we're refusing, on what terms and why, and then refusing it, right? And then doing the work of refusal. And here then it's the verb, it's refusal as a verb, to decline what's on offer. And we see this, for example, in the refusal of, you know, two easy forms of data ethics that might say, you know, well, a faulty facial recognition system means we just need more inclusive facial recognition systems, right? And there's a refusal to admit that kind of like easy liberal fix of inclusion. The second, I think, is a little maybe less evident in the term, but a refusal also operates as a reminder. that sexist oppression works not independent of, but in concert with these other axes of oppression. And in one obsolete use of the term refusal, actually refusal is a noun, and it's similar to what we would say refuse today, as in that which is discarded or thrown away or left at the wayside. And so I think we can hold that definition of refusal in mind to remember that that feminist refusals are not sort of straightforward goods in and of themselves, that if we refuse without being sort of simultaneously attuned to other axes of oppression, we risk discarding other women, non-binary people, and other groups that bear the burden of patriarchal oppression in different ways. So I have in mind here, you know, there's obvious examples like Audre Lorde's sort of repeated articulations of the racism and heterosexism that permeate sort of white feminist movements. But I'm also thinking of something like T.L. has written about elsewhere in the figure of the trans feminist killjoy, and somebody who, the figure that refuses the rhetorical, economic, and physical violences of course of gender norms, and also the exclusions and attacks practiced by some feminist communities against trans people, right? So I think here we might sort of resist or refuse what I see as emerging some tongue-in-cheek attempts to resist the patriarchal tendencies of big data. I've seen terms like big dick data floating around that you know, while catchy, we also might want to be cautious of essentializing these kinds of knowledge practices and equating them to anatomy in ways that might ultimately alienate women, trans women in particular, or others who would be our allies in these, right, who we want to be an affinity of hammers, as Sarah Ahmed puts it, that we're going to work together collectively to chip away at these histories. And then finally, so in this way, refusal demands we pay attention to the refuse, to what is discarded, and not be careless in our refusals. And then finally, the third element we've heard articulated here is this positive generative vision of refusal. Etymologically, refusal shares a root with refund and found, as in foundry, as in to melt something down and mold it into something new. Refundere, refusere, these are, they share a common Latin root. And so I think it's important to remember that declining patriarchy's offer does not mean sort of a complete or perfect disengagement with the resources or elements that it marshals in its service, but we need to confront those resources and elements in new and sometimes radically different ways. We can melt down and refound structures, systems, and ideas. And here we see, you know, refusal as Ruha Benjamin puts it, as seated with a vision of what can and should be, and not only a critique of what is, or as Anita put it, you know, as seated with a vision of the worlds we can't live without. And I would even, as a provocation, go so far as to call it a universal feminist value. Not universalist as in ways that Anita has written about really well elsewhere, about, you know, universal as equated with the West or with a certain kind of sort of masculinist vision of the world, but rather as being able to cut across culture and cultures and struggles in order to embrace refusal as this kind of collective action, as Tanya put it. And I think we actually are interested in doing that, and we shouldn't be so quick to concede the idea of a universal value, because that prevents claims from those who are oppressed from having moral sort of import and moral claim on oppressors, right? We're interested, I think, in universal values insofar as we're interested in the claims of the oppressed having moral purchase on oppressors. So that's my attempt to kind of bring together into a heuristic some of the various threads we've seen here. So the kind of three stages of what I think refusal brings to the table.
Thank you so much. And in part of what you were speaking about, you mentioned inclusion. And there's actually a question from Karen Levy about wanting to hear more, especially from Anna, about the relationship between rhetorics of refusal and rhetorics of inclusion. So I was wondering if you could respond to that.
Anna, is that yours or Tanya?
I can speak a little bit to some of that. So I think part of what is happening with the word inclusion, right, is that it is right now wrapped up with diversity and equity as a tripartite kind of goal that we should all be like working to get toward, right? Diversity, equity, and inclusion. Inclusion is kind of painted as this universal good, this ubiquitous good that is something that we should all want. And the fact of the matter is that inclusion is not actually something that everyone wants, right? There are very good reasons for cultures or communities to not want to be included in spaces that are violent or harmful or damaging to them. And so I think one of the strengths of a refusal ideology, perhaps, is in being able to say, no, actually, we choose not to be included in this space that we find violent, damaging, or harmful. Inclusion is not a ubiquitous good. Sometimes being included in something causes more damage or more harm. And the sort of rights of refusal, ideas about sovereignty, and as Anita mentioned, Ruha Benjamin's digital, I lost my word, digital liberation, right? So thinking about inclusion as something that may not actually be what is desirable is a direction that I think we've all been kind of working and thinking in.
I think it's really helpful to think when we hear terms like inclusion to recognize them as not, it's easy to get sort of, caught up in the rhetorical, like the positive rhetorical valence of a term like inclusion, right? Of course, we don't want to be exclusive, we want to be inclusive. But instead, if we shift that frame and we think about words as tools, and we think about inclusion as a tool, and Sarah Ahmed calls it a tool of governance, right? And so how is inclusion being used as a tool to either sort of reproduce or sustain the legitimacy of the very thing that those who are now being invited to be included have been refusing or rejecting or protesting? And how does inclusion then work as a tool to diffuse that kind of resistance? And so I think thinking about these values as tools, as much as they are sort of like, you know, words that make us feel good sometimes, I'm really great with words, as you can tell, I think remember that they are tools first and foremost is helpful for making sense of these moves.
Right, and just to underscore those beautiful framings, inclusion without some version of fundamental transformation is not inclusion. Inclusion into what? And so if it's really about new world building, it's not so much a sort of like, let me be drawn into your world. We've seen this in lots of institutions that bring on or take on the language of inclusion, but don't actually have any intention of remaking themselves as decolonial or feminist or anti-racist institutions as institutions and reforming the culture from the ground up. Inclusion, again, without a fundamental transformation is not actual inclusion.
Thank you so much. There's a question from M. Henry asking about if the current manifesto is considered a work in progress, how do you all expect it to change? How will you accommodate the experiences, morals, and beliefs of non-scholars?
Hi, this is Yael. Thanks very much for that question. It's a great question. And we've always imagined we've always known that this was the product of a bunch of professors in faculties of information. And we did circulate the the manifesto through some of our communities and got feedback about those from those folks. But we do know that it is also written for primarily a scholarly audience. And so one of the things that we've wanted to do and we've talked about is that we would love the manifesto to circulate in whatever form people need it, and then for people to do with it what they need and what is useful to them and what they want to do. And so at some point, so basically one answer is COVID is what has happened. So we really thought that over the summer, maybe we would be able to put on the website some like workshop tools and like ways of working with this. Here are some like, you know, if you're working in a community group, like here's some exercises to, you know, activate some of the materials and get people to think about them and get them to tease them out and then get them to write their own, which is always what our goal has been. It is for folks who engage with it then to write their own set of refusal and commitments. But to be honest, we just really couldn't do it because we were all getting our own courses up online, which is, I find, hell in many ways, and just so much more work, and then just the kind of emotional stress of everything. We just weren't able to get it done. So the answer is, you are more than welcome to take the manifesto as you want it, share amongst your folks. And one of the first things we want to do is to have Pat, I don't remember what we called it. It was super cute. It was like, I don't like natalist metaphors, but it was something like manifesto babies or something like that, where everybody, where people
call them kittens,
the kittens, manifesto kittens, exactly. That folks who made new stuff, whether it would be artwork or a new thing to add, that we would build a kind of gallery of this new material that then could then be circulated along with or instead of the manifesto for anyone who needs it. And then of course, you know, as data regimes change, this our sets of refusals and commitments will also need to change. And so it is absolutely a work in progress. And it's also meant to be an ongoing kind of collaboration, that there's a kind of open invitation to make it your own and to make your own. Would be my answer to that. And we just haven't been able to kind of build the infrastructure around making that super clear, but we're hoping to.
Yeah, if I could just say one last thing about that is that there are people who, you know, without our assistance in any way, have actually taken it up. I know people have used it as a pedagogical tool, like in the classes that they're teaching. There have been live readings of it. I think it's about to be incorporated into an art show, and Jazz and TL are gonna have to say the name because I've forgotten it. And you know, we always love to hear about them because we love to hear about how this sort of like provocation is being activated by different groups. At Allied Media, you know, that has a lot of sort of practitioners, the more practitioner-oriented conference, people who are doing justice work. And so we have seen it sort of like get a life of its own, and that has been really beautiful. And so if you know of anything, like, we would love to hear it. And like we said, we wanted to build an infrastructure around being able to share the way that it is taking a life of its own. That's just, you know, maybe I'll get a course buyout and do that, but this is not, we haven't been able to do it yet.
Yeah. But also, if you have ideas, like, be in touch with us, because that is something that is our, it's front of mind, but we just haven't been able to make it like front of time lately.
Thank you. There are two questions that I think are very related to each other. And I sort of wanted to read both of them and then hear what everyone thinks. So the first question is by Lily Rani, who asks, can you tell us about some of the specific spaces you've organized and what refusal has enabled there, lessons learned about organizing those spaces well? And then we have an anonymous attendee who's speaking about a binary gender recognition technology that their company is putting out, and asking about what collective coordinated actions that they could get involved with that you all might know about. They're talking about how facial recognition gets all the airplay right now, and it's in the news and everything, and some companies have backed off of it, as Jenna and Drudra talked about at the beginning. But what about some other issues like these gender recognition crap? So I think that both of these are really related to actionable organizing, and I wanted to know what people think about them.
I think if I could just jump in again, and I think when we wrote this, we, like Jazz said, or no, TL said it. It was TL. You know, this was always the vision was always that people were going to do something with it that was outside of what we could have imagined. And so, you know, like in all honesty, you know, whenever we do readings or talk about this, we went to Data and Society and did a collective reading. Some of the very real first questions that we get is, this is beautiful, it inspires me, but what am I supposed to do with this? Like, what am I supposed to do with this in my practice, in my art, in my life? And for us, you know, it was, you know, we obviously can't think of every edge case. And so we really want people to do with it what is the most useful to them. And I think that's sort of something we're trying to incorporate into our, you know, future readings, future presentations, future workshops, is for people to actually create their own commitments and refusals. And so basically to make meaning out of the text that's there, maybe not all 30 of them, but, you know, we have our top 10. And so in terms of, you know, Lily's question about what has it enabled there, we have seen different responses. Like we've been in some tech spaces where they're like, this is just like a bunch of high theory, I don't understand what this means. To spaces where we have lawyers who say, oh, you know what, like this really makes sense for, you know, this particular way that I'm handling sort of my criminal defense cases. And so it's really meant a lot of different things to different people. So it's kind of a hard question for me to answer. Maybe someone else has some ideas.
I hope she doesn't mind, but I'm hoping to put Tanya on the spot here. So I think at 4S, she and I were part of the same conversation, and I think she had some beautiful examples of how she's actually done this in the classroom as well that speak nicely to Lily's question as well.
Were you talking about me? My internet cut out, sorry.
I just volunteered you to talk a little bit about how you've actually done this in some of your classes as well.
Yes, so I have, since doing this in the, 1, 2, 3, 4 semesters, since we crafted the manifesto, I have given my students rights of refusal. And they don't have to explain why they are opting out of an assignment, and I've only had a couple people take me up on it, and they were very happy to explain. So as just one example, there was a student who was really uncomfortable that she couldn't see sort of the back end of Flipgrid, and, you know, didn't know what was going to be happening with the videos that she was recording, and didn't know, you know, what would happen to her likeness, and was really uncomfortable participating in any assignment that had Flipgrid associated with it. And so, you know, while that's an example of an individual refusal, it's one that has prompted me to reconsider even using that technology in the class, right? Because she raises a really good point. And I think that if I hadn't opened up that space and offered students the chance to say, no, I don't want to do this, then you know, for reasons, or not for reasons, then it wouldn't necessarily have prompted that reconsideration for me in terms of the technologies that I'm using in the classroom. And exactly, teaching, thank you, Lily, exactly. Teaching is a huge part of what we do with tech in the world. And especially now that so many of us are teaching online and we're trying to find ways to build community in our online classrooms, I think technology has started to play an even bigger role in our classroom spaces. And I mean, we all have so many pressures on us to really consider all of the implications of every single piece of technology that you might be using in your classroom setting. I mean, I know I didn't have time for that in the run-up to this semester, right? But I will not again use Flipgrid. And, you know, there have been concerns raised about Zoom, and Zoom was never intended to be used the way that it's being used right now. And so I think empowering students in the classroom to engage in refusal, whether that is individual or collective. And somebody did ask me at 4S when I brought this up, well, you know, what if you have a student that just says, no, I don't want to do the assignment, and it's just because they don't want to do the assignment. For me, that's their prerogative, right? They're paying for their education. And while I think it would be a shame for someone to lose a learning opportunity because they choose not to engage with an assignment, that's also a kind of policing, I think, that I'm not necessarily here to do. I'm here to increase knowledge, to share what I know, to learn with my students. And I think that's where the focus for me just has been.
Thank you so much, Tanya. Oh, go ahead, Anita, and then we need to wrap up.
Super quick addition to Tanya's beautiful extrapolation on how to use the classroom and think about the classroom is also sort of a model and a model space for these practices of refusal, but also other means of sort of using it. And I think the way we organized readings as well around the manifesto were also means of trying to think about how to bring in different voices and elevate different voices that are oftentimes excluded from those spaces. So to try and think about different organizations, when we organized some of our readings, we were intentional about it, about bringing in invitations for different kinds of voices who oftentimes aren't part of a data and society kind of circle or part of an information sciences or studies classroom, but that are nonetheless up to the on the ground work of doing critical data politics from their own sites. So trying to use those spaces to say these are occasions for gathering points and occasions to be able to also elevate work that is oftentimes refused or pushed out and marginalized in these kinds of conversations. That's one other way that both the classroom and these sorts of occasions for gathering spaces can be used as these sort of intentionally to create a different kind of collective.
Thank you so much, Anita. And there are a few questions left that maybe we could go and type in some answers to. I wanted to thank everyone for coming and listening, and a special thank you to the panelists. This was such an interesting conversation, and I have so much to think about now. Thank you.
Thank you, Niloufar, for wonderful hosting and moderating.
Of course, thank you.
Big thank you to Niloufar and to all the folks who organized this, and to everybody listening. I hope we have further chances to engage in the conversation if we didn't make it to your question.
Absolutely, thank you so much. This has been really lovely.
Totally, totally great. Thanks, everybody. Great to see everyone.
Thank you all.
All right, we're back with our next session of the Refusal Conference. I'm really thrilled to get to introduce the panelists for this keynote panel. The first is Professor Marisa Duarte from Arizona State. She is in the School of Social Transformation, and I have a copy of her book, Network Sovereignty, Building the Internet Across Indian Country, which I love in part because it refuses a certain dichotomy between kind of culture and nature and kind of indigenous ways of working and contemporary technology. Those are not kind of divided worlds in her work, which I love about it. Each of our keynote panelists is gonna speak for about 20 minutes. And then we are once again open for questions. I'm gonna keep an eye on the Q&A and try to kind of mediate between our speakers and the questions and help keep the conversation going. So Marisa, let me turn it over to you. You can go ahead and if you need to share your screen or anything, you can do that too.
Okay, I don't have slides. I just prepared some remarks. It seems like it's a strange, like a simulacra to create slides in a slide in a, you know, it's just too much for me. So anyways, thank you for inviting me to speak on the panel today. I'm a fan of the people who wrote the manifesto, and I've been super happy to have engaged in overt and covert acts of resistance with many of you who wrote the manifesto over the years. And I'm also super happy to see how the manifesto is inspired by the work of one of my colleagues in Native and Indigenous studies, Dr. Audra Simpson. So, you know, Dr. Simpson, for those of you who've met her, you know, she's a remarkable scholar. She has a great fashion sense. She's a compelling speaker. And most of all, she's a little bit of a prankster, which is an important part of refusal, right, is being light about it. So she sharply defends Mohawk territory as well as Indigenous epistemologies. And she persuades us to commit to decolonization intellectually, psychologically, physically, and politically. And furthermore, to refer to what our authors of the manifesto indicated, that decolonization is not metaphorical. It is material, legal, physically defensible, economic, and territorial. It is a shift in consciousness with tangible implications. So for this presentation, what I thought I would do was characterize the political will of Indigenous matriarchs who practice refusal. And I'll give a few examples of how the violence of algorithmic discrimination and panoptic surveillance rears its head against Indigenous women. And I'll close with a quick review of current work of Native and Indigenous women who refuse, who practice refusal by saying yes to data sharing structures that benefit Indian country. So they're remaking their worlds. So it's a no and then some. So I hope this presentation gives us the strength to consider the contours of the strong yes that predicates a persuasive no. So just, you know, for those of you, if you're not familiar with Indigenous approaches to feminism, you know, I won't go into the full complicated tangled history on that, but I am going to use on occasion a framing of Indigenous matriarchs. And that doesn't necessarily mean that matriarchs have to be, you know, childbearing women of status in tribally enrolled or federally enrolled tribes, right? It means rather that these are Indigenous people who recognize the matriarchy and matrilineage as sort of a way of belonging to Mother Earth, okay? So it's not just sort of like a inverse of patriarchy, or, you know, it's not an opposition to that. It's a completely different world framing. So that being said, all kinds of people can be Indigenous matriarchs, including people who do not have children. It's aunties, it's godparents. You have queer people who are Indigenous matriarchs, and you have men who are also very committed and uphold Indigenous matriarchy. So Indigenous matriarchs say no to colonial intrusions into the relationships that comprise our private sovereign spaces of activity. We say no to projects that make us canaries in the coal mine of technoscience. So a Simpsonian Indigenous feminist politics of refusal toward big data surveillance is also a refusal of capitalist systems of trade, warfare, and incarceration that render human beings consumers, laborers, and subjects of allowable violence. So in this, you know, I kind of really quickly scanned all of the I think 63 or so people who are attending today. And most of us are members of the creative class. So most of us shape public and intellectual discourse about social values one way or the other. And I argue that if we as members of the creative class do not retain the privacy of our interactions and relationships, we have no autonomous zones within which to organize against patriarchy. We lose command over the networks of trust that undergird feminist self-determination. And, you know, to borrow from the 1960s discourse, you know, the man is always listening, right? So where will we decolonize if he whispers through our thoughts and most private utterances and our homes, our eye movements, and the muscle memory of our children? So Indigenous thinkers have been concerned with these questions for centuries with regard to the amoeboid crawl of the settler Leviathan, the fog and the war of forgetting that deludes our senses, causing humans to lose touch with their dignity as beings born for the earth. So we're in a bind. Those of us in the creative class are also the ones who can afford to lock ourselves away from social engagement. My spouse's uncle, who is a tribal member and a long-haul trucker, jokes about how drivers get irritated by semis on the road. He says, well, quit buying stuff. Those trucks are filled with the goods to pad our capitalist safe houses. Those trucks cross borders. Truck stops and interstate highways are key locations for sex trafficking and the kidnapping and assaults of indigenous women, girls, and vulnerable peoples. I recently read an essay by Arjun Appadurai questioning the logic of assigning blame to interlaced infrastructures for their function in dispossession and displacement of peoples. And it's true that we run the risk of an endless finger pointing as infrastructures, including data infrastructures, are always in a tangle of progress and decay. They don't seem to have hard ends or beginnings. But then I remember that Appadurai is a cosmopolitan, and cosmopolitan desires drive the global marketplace. So I don't want to create this false dichotomy, right? Indigenous feminists can be cosmopolitan, just like we use social media toward activism, love, sex, self-expression, politicking, and care. But as Anishinaabe writer Leon Simpson notes about digital activism for Idle No More, the datafied world is no replacement for the trust built over generations through face-to-face interactions among Indigenous matriarchs and their families in Indigenous territory. Idle No More is territorial. It is not a hashtag. If big data sets are our kin, in the way that Métis scientist Maxley Baron suggests about all beings we enliven with our hands, then they are a troublesome kind, the kind we have to bail out, correct, apologize for, clean up after, and set right. In tribal communities, the rules of justice arc toward a faith in the people and our ancestral commitments to each other, our waters and lands. The rubric is largely restorative. Unlike Pontius Pilate from his seat on high, we thus cannot wash our hands of the habits of big data because we co-created it. And this is the essence of Indigenous reciprocity. So in previous presentations, I wondered if as Americans, and I know there's, you know, some folks from Canada too, so I might just kind of wrap you into this too. So I wondered if we are blithe prosumers because we tacitly put our faith in the doctrine of discovery, the 15th century papal bull that condones the taking of any lands, beings, or objects you can find that don't appear to belong to any one civilized, God-fearing man. Certainly a spreadsheet of millions of observations gathered from consumer and government data mining doesn't seem to belong to anyone at all. After all, they are observations of the avatars people create for themselves in bursts of activity through disparate platforms. They aren't people, they're holograms. For me, as a Yaqui woman who can perform as a Catholic but belongs to a non-Christian way of life, the soul is a hologram, just like God. It was sold to my people to make us obey a particular social and political order. So I don't sweat when somebody damns me to hell or praises me to heaven because I don't really believe in those wastelands, just like I don't believe that my social media profile is me. Indeed, this speaks to how we as Indigenous women also haunt the Americas. Are we ever really seen for who we are, or are we always seen for how the colonial powers need for us to appear? How does Amazon need your data double to perform? How can they coax you into reproducing their way of being? So Christian or animistic, seen or unseen, I do believe in colonization, and I experience mundane, ugly, and violent racial profiling fairly regularly. About a year and a half ago, two white women attempted to goad my spouse and I into a physical fight on an airplane while I was nursing my infant son. They accused my spouse of being abusive and violent because he had on a t-shirt with an Indigenous message, quote, kill the capitalist, save the Indian. The message is an inversion of the motto of Colonel Richard Pratt, 19th century administrator of Indian boarding schools, whose program of discipline was, quote, kill the Indian, save the man. Thankfully, a family seated behind us on the plane escorted us out and went ahead to baggage claim to make sure it was safe for us to enter. The mother of that family noted details about the two women and asked me to please file a complaint with the airline. I did, but as a working mother, and quite frankly, as a brown woman, I didn't expect any response, nor did I want to give energy to the process. Instead, I traveled with my spouse and son out to his homelands in Northern California, where we got our son named into the roundhouse. And we did what Indians do, and we're on our own. We hang out with other natives, we pray, we eat, we camp, and we spend time together. We did talk about it a bit afterwards, and I wasn't mad, and neither was he, but I was definitely scared. And that's the thing about surveillance. It's terrifying. It puts terror in your heart. But our baby was smiling through the whole thing, grinning at the teenage girl seated in the row behind us because he felt safe with his family. So that's the Indigenous thing, right? It's the safety is defined through relationships. The two women on that plane who chose to hate us because we're Indians recorded the interaction on their phones because I'm guessing they wanted to post it online and prove that Indians are violent and unpredictable and prone to attacking white women. So saying no as Indigenous women is an everyday circumstance. The no comes from deep inside, and it's strengthened by a deeper yes. The yes is to a faith in the bond we have with our peoples. The yes is to the truth of our histories and philosophies. the yeses to the health of the soil, waterways, trees and plants, four-legged beings, two-legged beings, mountains and shorelines. The yeses to our cyclical belonging to the moon and the nourishment of the sun. The yeses to the color of our skin, which is beautiful, and the old stories wrapped in our hair. The yeses to our inherent sovereignty and our privacy as tribal peoples, which we enforce through formal and informal ways. No, you may not know our stories and songs. No, you may not come onto reservation land. No, you may not take photos of the children. No, I will not affirm your imagined 1/32nd tribal heritage. No, I will not help you access the files of tribal citizens convicted of crimes on Indian land. As tribal people, we must protect our privacy because our self-determination depends on it. How can an oppressed people achieve autonomy if a colonial power constantly surveils them with the goal of eradication, conquest, and assimilation? So maybe this is the greatest way that hyper-surveilled people can be inspired by an indigenous feminist note. Algorithmic discrimination, as you all know, threatens the autonomy and self-determination of women, girls, children, Black people, people of color, immigrants, and LGBTQ plus families and communities. And I'm not offering an easy formula, admittedly. I know, those of you who are trained in the law, who practice law, are like, okay, here it comes. Okay, group privacy. that's a really hard thing, right? But you know, at an epistemological level, it means thinking at the level of a people, the way land-based tribal peoples do. It requires reimagining belonging and deliberative democracy, which is not common among Americans who prefer expediency, private property, and majority vote elections. It requires a renewed sensitivity to what privacy and trust means as we rely on social media to advance feminist political mobilization while creating territories of safety in a racist, classist patriarchy. So I will now shift to the work of Native and Indigenous women researchers who construct the means to bring the beneficial aspects of information and data flows into their community. So they're operating in the deeper yes. So Zuni Tlingit scholar Miranda Bilardi Lewis and I recently had the honor of working with Dene and Eastern Shoshone scholar Sandy Littletree to publish about the material impacts of Indigenous relationality for data, information, and knowledge sharing. Dara Blackwater, an up-and-coming ICT policy specialist, is now raising awareness of what affordable internet spectrum means for sovereign Native nations disenfranchised from internet infrastructure. So what she is doing, she literally heard the title of an article, an op-ed she recently posed was like, we need to say no to the well-meaning white man and get our sovereign rights of spectrum back. Confederated Tribes of Grand Ronde scholar Jennifer O'Neill has been working for over a decade on matters relating to sovereign spaces and physical and digital archives and who may not enter those areas. Anishinaabe scholar Jennifer Wemiwan has been partnering with elders and knowledge keepers to identify values for distributing deeply, you know, very profound Indigenous ways of knowing through digital means. And that is also about defining the space through which information flows. Apache scholar Kiara Vigil and Abenaki scholar Lisa Brooks have been applying network thinking to discern how Indigenous intellectuals use analog and digital platforms to share Native ways of knowing, usually siloed in the walled gardens of academia. So they are saying no to the assumption that Indians are just sort of have historically been disconnected from time and space and intellectual discourse, and that they should stay that way, hidden in the archives. Chickasaw researcher Tracy Morris advances federal policy on internet access in Indian country. If any of you have ever talked to Tracy, talk about a hard no. She's also into like punk, and I think her partner builds hot rod cars. I mean, you know, she is somebody who you want on your side in a lobbying battle. Atna scholar Stephanie O'Carroll and Northern Cheyenne scholar Desi Lone Bear Rodriguez initiated the US Indigenous Data Sovereignty Network, which was a part of the Global Indigenous Data Sovereignty Network, which Jazz and TL mentioned in the previous session. And Indigenous Data Sovereignty specifically is a body of work and a bunch of activist efforts and some legal efforts to access and acquire large scientific and government data sets based on rules of sovereignty. And it's, you know, so rules of sovereignty, you know, not to get too detailed, but they operate slightly differently for Indigenous peoples around the world. And so that's part of the struggle, is creating those structures to make it real. And finally, Sisseton Wahpeton Oyate scholar Kim Tallbear activates networks of Indigenous and queer feminist scientists who take up scholarly and political critiques of genetic data practices. And you have to be in the network to contribute to that work. So their research and wise words are seeding national acts. Savannah's Act in the US was recently signed into law after it was introduced 2 years ago by New Mexico Democratic Congressional Representative and Laguna Pueblo member Deb Holland. The act calls for coordinated and systematic data sharing across law enforcement agencies investigating forgotten and ignored cases of missing and murdered Indigenous women and girls. for generations, many of us have lived under the presumption that if we are assaulted or we go missing, no one's going to find us or seek justice on our behalf. And so this, we live knowing that our lives are more violent, regardless of our class status, regardless of achievement, because that violence is profitable. It's profitable to harm Indigenous people and women and girls in particular. So this act is significant, but it's asking us to say yes to data sharing. And that's the work that we have to do in front of us. We cannot afford not to engage in this work because the rates of assault in Indian country against women and girls is just, it's heartbreaking. It's heartbreaking. So in August, to bolster that and to build on that, Deb Holland and Massachusetts Representative Elizabeth Warren also introduced the Digital Reservations Act, which would increase support for internet infrastructure and digital skill building throughout Indian country. So to be able to engage the principles of the Feminist Data Manifesto, Native and Indigenous families, tribes, and communities need to develop a facility, a first level facility with the networks, platforms, devices, and infrastructures many of us in the creative class take for granted. We need to level up significantly. How can we say no if our students can't even upload their weekly fifth grade schoolwork? What algorithmic activities will we be able to say no to? You know, because it's our own tribal members, it's our own relatives who are running our own detention centers on our reservation. So we need to educate ourselves about this so that we can regulate that when we regulate the internet. So I will assert the following: Indigenous feminists and matriarchs say no to colonial intrusions of privacy based on their decolonial intergenerational knowledge of how to resist settler invasion. It is tacit embodied knowledge. It is sensory. It is tingling skin and gritted teeth. It is looking away, not showing up, avoiding, deferring. It is staring down, looking back, laughing back, arguing otherwise. It is slow sabotage. It's poetry and it's active refusal. It's dreaming. It is creating a space to dream of something better and making it happen. It's art making. It's cultivating a new way of being. The way to survive and resist colonial intrusions of privacy is to reinforce a deeper yes. So I hope these words inspire us to work together to contemplate the emergent yes as we push through political corruption, especially right now, and insist on feminist futures free of violence. Thank you.
If we have a couple of really burning questions, I think we could take them right now, and then I'll give Kim a chance to queue up her slides and get ready. I had one quick question that just sort of builds off of what you're saying at the very end, which I hear you loud and clear that the answer is not stay off the internet. It's somehow it's both embrace it and refuse parts of it, or refuse some of the logics. And I want to explain that just a little bit more. How do you embrace the internet and refuse it at the same time? And why isn't just, you know, if we stay off the internet and we don't allow our data to kind of propagate and percolate across it, isn't that a way of avoiding some of those kind of colonial intrusions you're talking about?
I'll give one example that, so I was recently asked to contribute to, I don't know if you know the work of Lena Densick. She's at, is it City College of London? I can't remember right now, but you know, she's in the UK and runs a center on data justice. And Lynette Taylor, who's also loosely affiliated with data justice movements in Europe, reached out to me and said, would you write a chapter about what data justice is affecting Indigenous peoples in North America right now with regard to COVID-19, because there's concerns about public health surveillance being used to discriminate or in some wrongful ways, right? And I was like, well, it would be great if we were even a blip on the screen. Like, there is no public health. There are small efforts at epidemiological public health surveillance in Indian country, but they're very limited. And they're not really matching up with the actual means of delivering public health. So like the community learning that you have to do, providing resources, the driving out into places to get people PPE and all the kinds of basic stuff, knowing the languages, you know, when working with elders and that. So I was like, well, you know, I wish we could even get to data justice. We even need to recognize that people are here. And in fact, after COVID broke out up in Canada, First Nations Assembly released a statement saying as sovereign Native people, First Nations, we need to even be at the table when you all are talking about how you're gonna collect data. You know, we have to even convince you that we exist. you know, and that includes including us in your budgetary considerations. And that was a huge fight in Canada and in the US for tribes to be included in the CARES Act funding. And in fact, tribes were not given funding from the CARES Act. It was withheld for like months, you know, when we desperately needed it. And so, so when we're talking about data justice in this particular context, you know, in terms of saying no, it's a matter of what we're saying no to, you know, and making strong, sort of like, okay, we need to be counted in this way, but not in that way. You know, we want some, and so that's why I kind of like draw back to Indigenous concepts of relationality. Maybe we can't control where data moves and goes, just like you can't really control water as it flows through the cycle. You know, like I can't tell which cloud it should go into. You know, I can't tell where it should rain. I wish I could, because then it would rain in Phoenix. We desperately need it in those drought areas, you know. But we can, in Indian country, we can make strong statements about relationships. And that's what Indigenous data sovereignty is about. And that's what respectful research partnerships are about, is about this. And that's what, you know, ethnographic refusal, Simpson's ethnographic refusal is about. This is me, I'm defining me, and here is you, and here's how we're gonna talk, you know? And that's why there's the bit of the prankster in it, right? But I like the data feminist data manifesto, because we need, for example, our radical Indigenous activists in the US, which Donald Trump recently like kind of demonized yesterday. Today's Wednesday. So 2 days ago when he released the US endorsement of Columbus Day, and he basically said anybody who tears down a Columbus statue is a, you know, is like a radical terrorist or something. So that, I guess, you know, puts me in a bad spot, right? But that you know, so we need our radical Indigenous people to be the ones who say no, so that our people who work with sovereignty and federal recognition can deliver on the deeper yes, you know? So no to killing, you know, Indigenous women and girls by engaging in cyber predatory acts through stalking them online. Because that's kind of the root of where a lot of that starts. The grooming and stuff like that is through social media, right? But yes to, you know, where we get different law enforcement agencies to share key data so that they can find, you know, and indict and bring to trial people who are involved in sex trafficking rings. So there's another side to this, right? So lately I have a colleague, Suta Calling Last, who runs indigenousvision.org, which is a group here in Phoenix that plots on a map, just using Google Map, like sacred spaces and place names and Indigenous place, you know, kind of knowledge, and anybody can access it. And she showed it to somebody who's involved in criminal investigation of missing and murdered Indigenous women and girls. And he looked at it and said, well, actually I see a clear pattern here, which you probably would not recognize, but a lot of these places that are mapped here as sites of violence that your users of this have contributed, you could also map sites of violence on it, is a known trafficking ring along interstate highways through the US and Canada and Mexico for women and girls for sex trafficking. So this data sharing, you know, where does it occur? How does it occur? What's the relationship around it? You know, is those are, I think, are the important questions to ask. I feel like I could talk for a lot more, but we have to make room for, you know, my colleague, you know, Dr. Christian. So, yeah.
All right, thank you so much. Okay, I'm gonna move on to Professor Kim Kristen, whose work I've known about for a very long time, and going way back to the mid 2000s, I think. And I think in particular, the work she's done talking about alternative Indigenous information systems and rethinking the default to openness, that information wants to be free, and that's necessarily something we all agree on. I think her work is some of the first work I read where I was like, oh wait, we don't all agree on this. there are other cultural logics that might guide what information is shared with whom and when and under what circumstances. So Kim, I'm gonna turn it over to you. She's a professor at Washington State University in Pullman. Try to screen share, and if we have any technical troubles, we'll troubleshoot that.
Okay. All right. Thank you. I want to begin by acknowledging that while this conference is online, it was organized by UC Berkeley that sits on the territory of the Ho Chun, the ancestral and unceded land of the Chochinyo speaking Ohlone people, the successors of the sovereign Verona Band of Alameda County. And this land was and continues to be of great importance to the Mawikma Ohlone tribe and other familial descendants of the Verona Band. I also want to situate myself as a settler scholar who lives and works on the homelands of the Nimiipuu and the Palouse peoples. I acknowledge their continued sovereignty and their stewardship of the land and the waterways. I also want to thank Jenna for inviting me and the amazing scholars of the Feminist Data Manifesto who I've learned so much from. And of course, to Dr. Duarte, who for her just inspiring work. I'm very much humbled to be part of the discussion. I also do have slides, so I am going to share my screen. So the image on my title slide is a provocative photograph by Native artist Zig Jackson titled Shooting Them, Shooting Us. Jackson's image evokes the physical, embodied, and material aspects of refusal, and it helps ground my discussion today in both the violent legacies and current forms and practices of cultural and intellectual and physical violence through technologies of collecting, recording, data gathering, reproduction, and display. It reminds us, as images and belongings circulate in digital formats, they carry with them embedded knowledge systems that refuse to be contained by Western legal systems or technical norms that define access parameters. For example, in the digital publication, As I Remember It, by Tsleman elder Elsie Paul, access to the site, its stories, songs, and photos are predicated on the acceptance of the quote protocol for being a respectful guest. Access is rooted in an obligation one makes to be a guest within this social system that is built on connections between places, language, and deep histories of belonging. So instead of a terms of service that already presumes access, these are terms of access that are situated in larger systems of obligation. There is no presumption that everyone can or should be able to use or reuse the content in the same ways. The shifting to defining access terms this way lays bare what Mohawk scholar Audra Simpson calls, quote, contesting systems of legitimacy and acknowledgement, end quote. And at the same time, it also forefronts epistemologies that are built on not looking or not seeing. It's quite common across Aboriginal communities in Australia for images of people who have passed away to be covered. In 2000, I accompanied a group of Warmungu women to Uluru and the visitor center on the traditional lands of the Pitjantjatjara people. We entered the cultural center and we saw several photo displays that were covered with masking tape and duct tape and cardboard. We learned from our Pitjantjatjara guides that a senior woman had recently passed away. And following community cultural protocols, images of her should not be viewed. The white curator refused to take the photos down, so the community members took matters into their own hands. So the tape is a physical, tactile embodiment of the protocols of the community, and at the same time, a clear refusal of Western visual sensibilities, museum practices, and the privilege accorded to Western systems of knowledge production. So for the last 24 years, I have worked with Warramunga women in Central Australia. And as part of our ongoing collaborations, we have recorded hundreds of hours of audio and video on country, following the tracks of ancestors, guided by the women you see in this photo and their kin. The explicit purpose of the women was to use the recordings as one way to continue to pass on knowledge and language to younger generations in their community. They saw the technology as a way to provide another avenue to sustain, grow, and share their cultural practices and knowledge. So by 2003, we had amassed quite a range of digital materials. We also traveled to several national museums and archives within Australia. And while what we found was certainly valuable to the community, how it was presented, often without attribution to Warmungu people, and who it was accessible to, often sacred materials were open to the public, did not follow community protocols. So the question very quickly turned to access protocols for the circulation of digital materials based in local understandings of knowledge circulation, exchange, and reproduction. So over the next 2 years, we worked together to create Mukdu CMS, a free and open source content management system and community access platform that explicitly addresses these issues of access and circulation protocols and indigenous attribution within its core functionality and architecture. All of the features and functions in Mukdu are determined through our community software development model in specific relationship to communities all over the world. So Mukdu literally means dilly bag in Warmungu. Michael Jumbin Jones, who chose the name, told me that elders used to keep sacred materials in the dilly bag and younger generations had to ask permission to learn. But elders also had an obligation to open up, to teach and to share within their kin networks. Access then is predicated on reciprocity, respect, and intergenerational knowledge sharing through very specific kinship obligations, and importantly, through these lines of attribution, that is, a very clear understanding of where knowledge comes from, who holds it, and who has access to that knowledge at any given time. Mukdu is similar to what Jennifer Wemigwans calls a digital bundle that, quote, represents a positive subversion on the internet by offering an indigenous history and imaginary that dares to challenge colonial ideologies by asserting the power and presence of indigenous knowledge, end quote. So within Mukdu, there are three core features that provide avenues for ethical stewardship and access. The first is cultural protocols. So these are really the heart and soul of Mukdu. They allow communities, however defined, to manage the circulation and access to materials at really granular levels. So maybe for specific kin groups or for specific language speakers, for example. But protocols are 100% customizable to the local needs of the community. There are absolutely no prepackaged protocols. Instead, they are defined by each community and updated continually because protocols obviously change over time. And importantly, there's no default open or public protocol. Every type of access has to be defined. Next, we have a suite of tools that we call round trip to provide an avenue for controlled import and export. This is a different type of return through a selective sync mechanism that allows communities to choose what to share back with institutions. So for example, sharing a location, not sharing a location of a sacred site, but sharing educational information about it, or not providing elders' knowledge, but allowing for updated metadata on specific names. So it gives that control back to the communities to decide what should be shared and how. Finally, our traditional knowledge labels, they're part of the local context initiative that I direct with Jane Anderson. And these provide an extra legal mechanism that sits alongside and disrupts copyright's power by shifting authority and attribution to indigenous knowledge holders. So as a platform, Mukdu provides one avenue for digital return and specifically a structural shift in attribution, authority, and access. So for the last 4 years, our teams at Mukdu and Local Context have collaborated with the Passamaquoddy Tribe and the Library of Congress to bring all these components of return together. In 2011, the Library of Congress began digitizing the oldest wax cylinders in their collections. Among them were the first recordings of Native communities in North America, those of the Passamaquoddy, recorded by anthropologist Jesse Walter Fuchs as a precursor to his salvage expeditions to the Southwest. So the Ancestral Voices Project seeks to not just return, that is, provide digital copies to the tribe, which they could have done easily, but also to reframe the materials and restore Passamaquoddy stewardship of the materials in the library's collection and return them back to the community for their own stewardship. So after a year of consultation, 31 digital files were restored and returned to the Passamaquoddy. In April 2016, my colleagues Jane Anderson, Guha Shankar, and I sat in the Wabanaki Center in Calais, Maine with Passamaquoddy community members listening to the recordings, many for the first time. And as we did, something beyond listening happened.
Even
Singing in the present by Gracie Davis, then another, then many, young and old, remembering the songs and words of their ancestors. And over the next year, the recordings circulated within the community. And the tribe's historian and elder, Donald Soctoma, spoke about the work and the significance of return.
What I'm doing with the wax on the recordings is I'm taking them to the community. We're having group listening sessions. And some of our younger singers that can't speak the language, but they understand music, they're taking the beat. The beat's really important. And then they're learning the language to fill that in. And it's making a complete circle. Like I spoke to before about the circle, how it comes around and comes back to the community. Now we have our ancestors from 1890 speaking to us, you know, that's really powerful, really powerful. And you wouldn't believe some of the people, you know, the older people break down and cry when they hear the songs of their great-great-grandfather or the stories that they heard bits and pieces of before. So the labels are going to be powerful on this too, because some of these songs are only meant for certain ceremonies. Some are only meant for men. Some are only meant for women. And then the stories, some of the stories, what I'm afraid of is somebody might hear the story and write a book about it, and then they claim ownership of the story. You know, that's happened before.
Here, Donald speaks directly to the significance of what he calls that circle of return back to the community. And at the same time, the very precarious position Indigenous communities are in relation to materials that have been collected and circulated without proper attribution or acknowledgement. And he gestures to the use of the TK labels to help with this predicament to restore Passamaquoddy rights. And it was during the following year, as the recordings circulated in the community, that the Passamaquoddy decided to use Mukadu and the TK labels to manage and make accessible some of the recordings and other cultural materials in their archives. So their Mukadu site, at home on the ocean and lakes, orients us immediately to Passamaquoddy homelands and waterways, grounding the site's materials and knowledge in places and people. There's also a page on the site dedicated to the TK labels, to explain what they mean and why they're being used. But the intent is very clearly stated at the top. Quote, "We consider ourselves to be the authority and custodians over these recordings, regardless of who is considered the legal owners," end quote. So refusing the legal straitjacket of copyright, their assertion makes plain the proper attribution and knowledge source for the returned recordings. They also created a collection and named it the 1890 Passamaquoddy Phonographic Recordings. This is exact to the opposite of the Library of Congress's catalog, which had been named the Fuchs Collection. They also added an image of Noel Joseph, one of the Passamaquoddy singers and storytellers for the recordings. So this repositioning immediately shifts not just attribution, but also, and significantly, authority. It's now the Passamaquoddy and Noel Joseph's whose knowledge and name will be cited and circulated. And the citational shift is not insignificant. For 126 years, these recordings have been cataloged and continually cited, with Jesse Walter Fuchs as the author, denying the authority and knowledge of the Passamaquoddy peoples. And as we drill down further, we see that the songs have been retitled in Passamaquoddy. And we also see in this case, they have a public access protocol. So in Mukurtu, every piece of content has to have a protocol, even if it's public. And we wouldn't be seeing this if it wasn't public. All access has to be defined. And then as we scroll down further on the page, we get to the community metadata. There are now Passamaquoddy tribal members listed as creators. There are three TK labels, extended cultural narratives from different community members, and traditional knowledge, including the video by Gracie Davis that we just saw and others. A great video in there of the school children singing the same song. So after almost 2 years of community vetting of these 31 files for access concerns and added knowledge, some, but not all of the material was returned, this time back to the Library of Congress for inclusion into the library's updated catalog records. So the new Library of Congress record for the trading song as of June 2018 has the updated title with Passamaquoddy names and the Passamaquoddy language. And there are now significantly three TK labels, all right at the top of the fold, that define access, attribution, outreach, and non-commercial. And these have all been customized by the Passamaquoddy to define what each of those means. So in September 2018, we held the community return event about 200 yards from the original spot where Passamaquoddy singers and community members recorded those very first wax cylinders in Calais, Maine in March 1890. Passamaquoddy singer and knowledge holder Duane Toma sang the trading song, and afterwards he told the crowd gathered at the community center, quote, "These recordings are gifts that have been left from the ancestors for us, and we are going to leave gifts for the next generation," end quote. The return of the digital files allowed the community to refuse standard information flows and protocols, citational standards, and entrenched narratives of loss and erasure. Instead, Gracie Davis, Donald Sock Toma, Duane Toma, and other Passamaquoddy community members are doing their own repair work, rooted in place, through language, and through their own networks of kin, refusing to allow Fuchs to remain the central figure in the knowledge production of Passamaquoddy peoples. And it was just 1 week before this in 2018 that Jeremy Dutcher won Canada's highest musical prize, the Polaris Prize for Album of the Year. And the song Jeremy sung as he accepted it was very familiar. As we discussed his award at the Wabanaki Center that day, we learned that Jeremy was directed to the Museum of Civilization by his auntie, Maggie Paul, to look for recordings made by the anthropologist William Meshling just a few years after Fuchs, just across the river from Calais. What he found were his Maliseet ancestors' songs. It turns out that Maggie Paul, Jeremy's auntie, and Gracie Davis from Passamaquoddy are sisters. Their shared knowledge moving between community members and across both sides of an artificial national border. As he accepted his award, Dutcher remarked, quote, "You are in the midst of an Indigenous Renaissance, Canada. Are you ready to hear the truth that needs to be told? Are you ready to see the things that need to be seen?" End quote. Dutcher's research, his use of traditional songs, and his album refused to place Indigenous knowledge and its circulation with and through technology in a position of vulnerability. Instead, he reframes technologies and their use around Indigenous bodies, language, and land within local circulation routes that replace technology within systems of obligation. On the album, Dutcher confronts technology's gaze and power through his narrative as the songs begin. We hear an interview he did with Maggie Paul, and she tells him, quote, "When you bring the songs back, you're going to bring the dances back. You're going to bring the people back. You're going to bring everything back." Like Donald Sauktoma's insistence on the circle of return, Maggie Paul places the emphasis on the physical, embodied, material, and intangible aspects of return from within the community. So Jeremy Dutcher's work shows how research that was meant as an instrument of erasure can be refused, reused, and made into acts of repair. Not repair that is beholden to settler notions of recognition or reconciliation, but instead repair that is driven internally by Indigenous peoples through their own terms of access. Thank you.
All right, take a breath. And I think we're ready for some questions. We have about 12 minutes to take questions for either of the panelists. There's a set of questions that are actually directed at one of the previous panelists. And if I don't see another question, I'll pick that one up because I think there's some things that are relevant for you too as well. So the question that's come through is actually for Anita Say Chan, and asking about One Laptop Per Child, her study, the One Laptop Per Child project. But the question was about, which I think is relevant for you too, is about data activists who want to use data to contest power. And I think both of you are talking about exactly that. So I'm not sure if this is just asking you to restate what you've said in your talks, maybe. But how do you use the logic of these technologies to fight back, to dismantle oppressive power structures? I think one question I have is, how do you do that without, I mean, there's the famous Audre Lorde quote that the master's tools will never dismantle the master's house. How do you use these tools without succumbing to that?
I saw that question. I was like, oh, actually, I'm working on a problem exactly like that, or related right now. So I'm working on a project right now with a number of other computer scientists in New Mexico, or we're working in New Mexico. And our project started out before COVID hit, and it was to extend the internet infrastructure for a joint cooperative network that also serves foreign sovereign native nations in northern New Mexico, as well as rural communities in the area. New Mexico has terrible public education. I am a product of the New Mexico public schools, so I don't want to say that, you know, I'm not trying to be I'm a part of it, I should say. I'm a part of that landscape. Anyways, you know, we were, there was a question in the previous panel about OCAP, the First Nations principles of OCAP. And our group used OCAP to help sort of negotiate with our project partners how to extend internet infrastructure, what technologies to use, where innovation would take place, how to protect the privacy of tribal internet users, because we had to collect web traffic to sort of design appropriate technologies for those spaces to do the analysis and so forth. So we worked through all that. COVID hits, you know, and the tribes are just hit really hard. They close their borders. If you're not a tribal member living on the res, you couldn't come on or off. As you all know, universities restricted travel and all this kind of stuff. So everything just ground to a halt. But then it was revealed, those of us who've been working in Indian country on digital divide stuff, we know this, right? That the digital divide is just like, that word is not even capture the number of barriers and the structural marginalization, the technological redlining that makes internet access so hard to come by in Indian country. And so when COVID-19 hit and all of a sudden students had to suddenly shift and teachers had to shift to distance learning, it became just wildly apparent that Native youth, Hispano and Mexican youth, poor kids throughout New Mexico were just not going to be able to finish the school year and would probably are not doing so great this year. A lot of the schools shifted to mail-in options only because that was kind of the only thing that was possible. And it's like we're still hearing stories about parents who are driving like to a McDonald's 45 minutes away and sitting with five kids in a van for like a few hours to use the free Wi-Fi in the parking lot to try to upload homework and stuff. So anyways, New Mexico distributed all these kind of tech do-gooders came in, and that's me being a little bit decolonial judgmental, but they came in and they distributed the Google Chromebooks, you know, as kind of this last ditch effort to try to get students connected. And this was done along with rapid deployment of mobile hotspots throughout the area. And we ran into a couple of problems. And one is that the Google Chromebook, supposedly you can work offline, but have any of you tried to use a Google Chromebook offline? Like, it doesn't work, okay? Like, I mean, it's just, you can try to do it, but you have to be like really proactive in thinking about what work you want to work on offline to be able to do that. So that means the teacher has to create a curriculum that could be completely done offline, put it on there with instructions for like a third grader, how to do that, take it home, the child does whatever they do, and then goes back and knows how to upload it. So the levels of digital skill, digital literacy, you know, the pre-planning, you know, that's just not the way people learn, you know, it's just such a epistemic shock, right? So yes, it's a good effort. And I will say, what is the data activist look on this thing? Well, we are learning from this situation. And in the true form of sort of radical justice work, it's like, okay, you know what? I'm gonna let go of my, you know, this is how I'm feeling about it. I'm really frustrated. I feel like this is a real colonial moment. I know it is, you know, and we have all these people who are expressing anger and frustration, sorrow, doubt, on top of the grieving, you know, about how internet access is impeding health, work, and education. But now we have the proof. Now we need to go in and collect the evidence. And so we're working with people who are developing these maps and overlaying personal experience of Native folks on top of those maps. Some of these are community generated maps. Some of them are generated in partnership with the state to deploy resources, including fiber, optic networks and stuff. And we can use that to kind of push back and say, here it is. Here's the proof that the federal government has been lying to us about penetration rates of internet in Indian country. And that's why we can't build out, you know? So that's kind of like, it's really important to me, solidarity. I'm a little bit practical this way, is like, at what specific point of action can we have solidarity? To what agency, around what? And that part of that comes from sovereignty, right? Like, we have to know where territories end and begin and who has control and who doesn't and that kind of thing. So that's my response to that question. I don't know if that's, very interesting. Thank you for addressing my massively convoluted question. That was my massively convoluted answer.
There's another question. There are a couple questions actually from Lily Arani. I'm going to take the second one, which addresses both Kim and Marisa. She says, thank you for these incredible talks. And do you see ways to form and navigate solidarities with left groups that want to see more equitable provision of digital knowledge and resources, but that might use the language of public to talk about it? I'm thinking she means like public interest or for the public, public good. And can it be coherent to talk about being public and decolonial at the same time? Or is there different language marking knowledge of how to navigate this? So I'm thinking she's asking about opening up those solidarities beyond kind of indigenous groups, self-identifying indigenous groups, to other allies.
I think there's been actually a lot of that in the last 10 or 15 years, where when we first started with Mukurtu, it was pigeonholed as digital rights management. We got all kinds of flack. I mean, you know, why, everything should be open, and like, how can you do this? And we never got grants, and it wasn't flying. But we shifted the language and started talking about sharing protocols, because really, who doesn't like sharing? Like, sharing's good. So we shifted that language. It's still exactly the same. The technology does the same thing. But by shifting that, we were able to move the needle. And we, you know, the partnership with the Library of Congress was not an insignificant maze of bureaucratic stuff. You know, the technology was one part of it, but you had all these, you have technological structures, you had different metadata schemas, you had, you know, what do we do with the very original records? What do we do with all these legacy records? You know, trying to think through that and to get all those people around the table to shift and say, none of that actually matters because your legacy material was stolen from the beginning. Right? So whatever was written down and handed to you, Fuchs didn't speak Passamaquoddy. Like the names of most of these songs are just wrong. That's why it took 2 years for the community to listen and listen and listen and come back and say, no, and no, and no. And so it was just a lot of conversation that had to go back to say, we're going to share these in the right way they were intended, and to walk backwards through that to see. And when you get it, particularly librarians, archivists together, and you, you know, kind of take them back the breadcrumbs to say, we're getting back to this knowledge that is the knowledge that it comes from. They do want that knowledge. You know, they want to have the kind of correct record, even though there isn't one, right? There's never just going to be one. So it was also refusing that kind of notion of an authority record. But I think those alliances can be built from within, but they're slow and they're long roads. And those of us who are settler scholars also have to step aside and take the back seat and push, you know, for the libraries and other people to work directly with the indigenous communities, which is why something like Mukurtu or the TK labels, they don't have to involve me or they don't have to involve Jane. They're out there for communities to use as tools to go and say you want to give these materials back and you want to reframe them, here you go. Because before that it was like, oh, we don't have, like, there's nothing for us to do this. We can't do the exchange, it'll be really hard. These systems aren't interoperable. So in any case, I think, you know, there are ways. I don't think talking about using the language of the public is necessarily beneficial. I think we can pivot from it, but still maintain those people who want to, you know, kind of do the right thing.
So I'm gonna just flag one thing you said and invite Marisa to add anything. So there was an earlier mention in a panel before, I think it was the Feminist Data Manifesto panel, talked about terms with positive rhetorical valence. And the term was inclusion. And I'm thinking, okay, so you found the right term. It moved from terms with negative rhetorical valence, like access control, to ones that had positive ones, like sharing. And I also just want to point back to something I said at the very beginning about thinking really broadly about the solution space. And you've proposed a very direct technological intervention as a kind of solution. But I also hear you talking about kind of a discursive intervention that's sort of solved some of the problems you were facing. Yeah.
I always say that Mukurtu is not a technology solution, it's a social solution, you know, because the technology in and of itself isn't going to do anything, right? And without the communities or the people that are going to put it to use, so.
And then Marisa, do you have anything to add to this? We're at the very end of our session, so you can have the final word.
Okay, well, I'll just say, you know, the word public for sure, for me is a Yaqui person, right? Yaqui woman. When I hear the word public, I'm kind of like, oh geez, that's a settler word. Like, you know, I don't say that's a settler word. I just kind of do the oh geez thing, right? Like, and just wait for what's coming next. Like, what are they going to ask me to give up, you know, to be part of this public? So yeah, it does invoke a certain world, right? But, you know, tribes have publics, you know, especially sovereign nations. We have our own public. We have our own private within tribes. We have levels of privacy in public within tribes. So that's important, is that, but you know, as tribal citizens, we're also part of the broader national public. And it's in a very important relationship, because we have to remember the origin in Canada and in the US of reserves and reservations, right? Which was that this was a place where sort of the natural resources, the primitive capital of the burgeoning United States and Canada could, you know, they could hold that stuff there. And then when they needed it, they could go in and plunder so that they could rebuild or replenish, you know, whatever they needed for westward expansion, you know, and for settlement, right? And so this is why over history you see reservations and reserves shrinking, right? As people try to get access to oil, timber, like whatever, you know, water. And so when we understand that reserves and reservations are places that are supposedly the common good, right? They're supposedly the origin of the commonwealth in these countries, then we see why we need Americans who are not just, who are not native, right? We need our neighbors and our allies to stand up for us in protection of those sovereign spaces, because those waterways, that's for everybody, right? So if we rethink public in terms of the good for everybody, that, you know, we can't live without clean water, we can't live without clean air, you know, we can't live without trees and the wildlife to live as they're meant to be, you know, that sort of takes power away from like, well, this is my public, you know, and that was, this is one of the fundamental sort of epistemic battles around No DAPL, right? Was that the near neighboring town said, no, we don't want this oil pipeline coming through here, but the Indians like put it through there, right? Even though they voted against it. And then they were like brutal racist, you know, and bigoted toward water protectors, right? Even though they had said, we agree personally, we don't want an oil pipeline through our backyard, you know? So I just always kind of draw back on the words. I went to hear Winona LaDuke speak one time, and she just gave me, she wasn't talking about data infrastructures, but that's how I kind of read it, right? She said, justice is infrastructure for the public. And since she was speaking from, you know, her Green Party stance as an Indigenous woman who honors the earth, right? That's how I interpreted. The public is about honoring the earth, because we're not going to make it through this thing, no matter who you are, you know, without some of these fundamental environmental restorations. So I think that's how I sort of, that's how I kind of think about the public. But yeah, I appreciate Dr. Kristen's like turn. Like, what if we just shift this? Like, if you know you're going into a room of like these very corporate oriented folks, you know, who don't think about Mother Earth, like maybe let's not talk about the public right now. Like, let's change the terms of the discourse.
All right, I'm going to conclude there with the session. Thank you so much for your time and for your deep and articulate thoughts. And what we have next lined up, basically, I sense that the attendees are out there just burning to talk a bit and not just witness these panels. And so what we have lined up is basically kind of like the virtual equivalent of a reception where we'll all meet, not in a webinar format, but a regular Zoom meeting room. And if it's too big, we can split off into breakout groups. And I really hope we can kind of continue some of these conversations in that space. So that's what's up next. Thank you so much. We're going to post a link to that, the next meeting, Zoom meeting room. So anyone who wants to can join us.